In 1844, Turner completed one of the most brilliant paintings of his last years. He called it Rain, Steam and Speed. Its subject was an early steam train, rushing through a landscape of swirling fog and vapour during a torrential downpour. These dramatic effects of blur and rush celebrate a new, speeded-up vision. The train, for Turner, wasn't just a contraption which moved him from place to place more quickly than ever before. It moved him emotionally. It made him see the world as never before. In this picture, Britain's greatest painter had looked the changing world full in the face. He'd found it beautiful. He'd found it exhilarating. But the Victorians would take a different view. In 1862, W.P. Frith, pillar of the Victorian art establishment, completed his version of the railway age. It's called the Railway Station. And what a stationary picture it is. Victorian Britain is hurtling into the future, but art's gone into reverse. No impetuosity here. The picture's a still life or frieze of the British class system, an image of how a community should properly function. There's room on board for everyone, or at least everyone who plays by the rules. Two detectives arrest a crook as he tries to climb aboard. The political conservatism of the painting is mirrored by the conservatism of its style. There's none of Turner's beautiful exuberance here. All that's been timidly turned away from. Frith's painting doesn't say yes to change, yes to new ways of seeing, yes to the future. No, it says no, not really. We'd like things to stay as they are, thank you very much. The cautious nature of Victorian taste often produced conservative art. But Victorian conservatism itself was complicated and urgent. It was their way of staying sane. The Industrial Revolution convulsing Britain meant new science and new industries. New industries meant new working practices, new cities, new and often squalid living conditions. And the faster the express train of industrial and scientific change and discovery travelled, the more the Victorians came to think of their art as a necessary brake applied to all those turning wheels. This watercolour of Manchester by William Wilde was commissioned by Queen Victoria herself in 1851. In the foreground, rustic swains dally beneath a tree. But beyond, a monster lurks. Wilde's attempt to incorporate Manchester's brick forest of smoking chimneys into a vision of Arcadia is pitiful, like trying to disguise a heavyweight boxer as a shepherdess. Yet it's also very revealing. Manchester, this new industrial reality, couldn't be made to conform to the old stereotypes of beauty. In a small country like Britain, the effects of rapid industrialisation were particularly visible. All across the nation, people saw the first smogs descend. Their world literally became darker. The art critic John Ruskin coined a disturbing phrase for this. He called it the dark storm cloud of the 19th century.
Machines, factories, cities, that whole vast sprawl of things that go under the name of the new had changed his world with the suddenness of a lightning strike. No wonder they seemed like terrors to him.
Ruskin voiced the fears of an entire generation of well-to-do Victorians who simply turned their backs on the hard facts of industrial life. That's why there's only a handful of Victorian paintings of factories. Instead, journeyman artists gave their public what it really wanted. Not the world of work, but soft-centred, chocolate box images of society at home or at play. The Victorian period represents that moment when so-called middle-class values came to pervade the entire nation. That's why the eye can move effortlessly from this, Frith's portrait of an unexceptional, modestly well-off family, his own in fact, to this, Edwin Landseer's portrait of the royal family, which Landseer completed in 1845. It's one of the most mundane portraits of royalty ever painted. This is monarchy striving for a suburban, cosy respectability. Proof that by mid-century, almost everyone was aspiring to join the swelling middle rank of society. These pictures encapsulate what we now think of, rightly or wrongly, as the defining values of the Victorian age. A belief in the sanctity of the home, in the God-given duty of man to pursue the good active life, and of woman to cultivate the more passive virtues of prudence and chastity. A belief in the importance of piety, and, above all, in the goal of constant self-improvement. It's no surprise that Victorian artists look back to the example of William Hogarth, Britain's first painter by appointment to the middle class, and to the tradition of moralising narrative art that he'd founded. That tradition had been kept alive during the early part of the 19th century and into the Victorian period by the Scottish painter David Wilkie. Wilkie painted what Hogarth would have called modern moral subjects, unpretentious pictures of everyday life, like his Distraining for Rent of 1815, in which we see a bailiff and his clerk calling on a smallholder who hasn't been able to keep up with the rent. Wilkie was a much less punishing artist than Hogarth, much less of a caricaturist. There's a gentleness in Wilkie's characterisation, a real sympathy for the plight of the agricultural poor. There's even a benevolent softness in his use of light. Wilkie's sympathy points towards Victorian sentimentality. He was a novelist in paint, and his use of narrative prefigures the firm Victorian belief that every picture should tell a story. The 19th century saw a great resurgence of the old British habit of making images subservient to words. For many Victorians, art appreciation simply meant finding the sermon in the painting. This celebrated triptych, Past and Present, by Augustus Egg, first exhibited in 1858, was a sermon on the commandment, Thou shalt not commit adultery. In Egg's first picture, a wife has succumbed to temptation and been found out. The essence of the story is in the details. The house of cards is collapsing. The wife will exit through the open door. In the second picture, the two girls, now almost grown up, dream wistfully of their mother. At the same moment, the wife, now destitute, contemplates what might have been. Female adultery was a hotly debated issue at the time, and this was Egg's way of showing Victorian Britain what dreadful things happen when women get carried away. It's a proudly middlebrow art, which has left its mark on British culture. Pictures like these are the moral and visual origins of the soap opera. Egg's most brilliant invention, Travelling Companions, is another meditation on female sexuality. One woman is associated with virtue in the form of an improving book, the other with vice, or at least forbidden fruit. The picture's an ingenious attempt to depict the notion of inner moral choice. Not really a picture of two people seen from the outside at all, but a painting of one person seen from the inside. You could almost fold the two girls into one another, such is the symmetry of the painting. Within all of us, Egg implies, there's the potential to be good or bad. I'm not sure that the effect is quite as morally improving as it was meant to be. The picture's on a knife edge of ambiguity. I get the impression that Augustus Egg was rather excited by the idea that inside every virtuous young woman
there's a bad girl waiting to get out.
Most Victorian works of art attempt to keep that kind of subversive excitement at bay. Their morality worked on much the same principle as the steam locomotive. Contain emotions, build up pressure, push on forwards, and just occasionally, let off steam. The 19th century was the first great age of mass leisure and of mass gatherings, which were made possible by the new network of railways. We're so used to the crowds at sporting events that we take them for granted. But in the 19th century, the crowds that gathered, say, on race days were a new, often disquieting phenomenon. Trace memories of the French revolutionary mob and working-class Chartist rallies still haunted the Victorian imagination. A crowd was always a potentially dangerous thing. This new pattern of social behaviour and the uneasiness which it provoked were memorably woven together in Frith's most famous painting, Derby Day. Frith tamed his crowd by organising it into a gallery of stock characters, all instantly classifiable to a contemporary audience. Part of the fun was working out who they all were. Here's the shifty criminal. Frith based him on a notorious murderer. And here's the young city clerk, who's been tricked out of his money by card sharps. They might be lively, but they're all stereotypes. There's nobody truly strange. No one who doesn't fit a preconceived idea about character. The picture reminds me of the novels of Dickens, where apparent human plenitude can mask an actual thinness of characterisation. Derby Day has a cast of thousands, but not a single real human being. The impulse that led the Victorians to paint crowds also led them to invent that most Victorian of institutions, the National Portrait Gallery. The National Portrait Gallery is the crowd painting turned into a museum, an institution which takes the largest crowd of all, the inhabitants of the past, and tries to turn them into an unruffled society of the venerable and the worthy. The NPG combined two strains in British history. The old national attachment to portraits joined forces with Victorian moral fervour to create a new kind of art institution. A gallery of good examples, a museum of good behaviour. The effect slightly surreal, because so many of the people gathered together would clearly have hated each other. As the 19th century progressed, cities themselves became open-air portrait galleries. The intimidating ideal community, this time in the form of a stone statue, colonised the grand civic squares of the new industrial cities, like Manchester, Birmingham, and Liverpool.
The Victorians loved to construct ideal communities. It was partly their way of fantasising about a better and more orderly world than the one they lived in. Their most vivid dream of social harmony was a dream of reviving the Middle Ages, because the Middle Ages of the Victorian imagination was everything that their thoroughly modern world was not. A time when all things were bright and beautiful, when every man, from the lowest labourer to the richest lord, knew his place. A time when there was no doubt.
The broken medieval remains of the old Catholic faith had haunted the British ever since the first destructions of the Reformation in the 16th century. Watercolours of ruins in the Gothic style, as medieval architecture came to be called, had been popular since the mid-18th century. The Victorians took this picturesque fascination with Gothic a stage further. Building in the Gothic style became one of their most powerful ways of defining themselves. The Houses of Parliament, designed in 1836 by Charles Barry, could never have been built in the classical style, the architecture of pillars and porticos, because that would have seemed too French, too republican, too revolutionary. The choice of Gothic here was meant to signal the nation's perpetual benign conservatism. But as the century progressed, to some people, Gothic became yet more important than that. In 1836, Augustus Pugin, who worked with Barry on the Houses of Parliament, published this curious, dyspeptic little book called Contrasts. Pugin was the first in a long line of Victorian thinkers to argue that Gothic is good for the soul. For Pugin, who was a Catholic convert, the architecture of the Middle Ages was a scourge to beat the British back towards a virtuous life. In Contrasts, he artfully juxtaposed an engraving of an imaginary modern city with how that same city might have appeared in a better, Gothic past. As an architect, Pugin seldom had the financial backing to realise his dreams. The Catholic Church of St Giles, at Cheadle in Staffordshire, was one of the few buildings where he was able to pull out all the stops. The rich neo-medieval decoration, all designed by Pugin, must have stunned the first congregations. Colour and pattern like this hadn't been seen in a British church for two centuries or more. Pugin sets the gorgeous solemnity of medieval Catholic ritual in opposition to his contemporary world of mechanisation, a world of hard times, of belching chimneys, of getting and spending, and religious doubt. One of Pugin's first jobs was designing sets for the theatre. And what a fantastic piece of theatre this is. But there's something insubstantial about it all. There's no dread, no holy terror. It's like a doll's house. It's stunning, but all the same, it looks more like wallpaper than medieval wall painting. Victorian idealism had a funny way of turning into decoration. By the time of his death in 1852, Pugin had gone completely insane. He had found the reconversion of Britain to the true principles of Gothic far harder than he'd ever imagined. But, in a century of radical change, the idea that somehow the past could restore order to the present was extremely persistent. Even the most forward-looking Victorian thinkers, like the revolutionary socialist and designer William Morris, had a habit of looking back. Morris lived here at Kelmscott in Oxfordshire. He dreamed of setting people free from factories. Everyone in his utopia would be a fulfilled and happy craftsman, or so the theory went. He took the positive step of founding a business, Morris & Co., though of course the number of people he actually released from the drudgery of factory labour into the joy of manual craft can be counted on the fingers of one hand. This isn't to underestimate Morris's visual brilliance. From the craft traditions of the East, he brought a whole new vocabulary of shape and pattern into Western European design. Morris never intended the Morris style to express his political beliefs. but his designs do hint at just that dreaminess and nostalgia which made him an ineffectual political thinker.
Unworldliness wasn't Morris's failing. Every self-respecting utopian is a bit impractical. No, his greatest failing was that, like so many other members of that designing, planning, idealising, we know better than you class of Victorian, Morris couldn't tug himself away from the past.
The truth is that the industrial world was here to stay. Karl Marx, writing Das Kapital in the British Museum in the 1860s, recognised that. The only question for him was who was going to own the machines. By contrast with the forefather of the Russian Revolution, there's something rather pathetic about Morris. A theorist for universal social change who got sidetracked into a world of handicraft and who left his most lasting mark on the world in the form of hand-blocked floral wallpaper. In 1850, the young Dante Gabriel Rossetti completed this painting, Behold the Handmaid of the Lord. It's in a hard, clear style, inspired by Italian medieval art from before the time of the Renaissance painter Raphael, hence pre-Raphaelite. This curious picture of a tubercular Virgin Mary is a pale but determined attempt to infuse 19th century painting with the spirituality of the Middle Ages.
Together with William Holman Hunt and John Everett Millais, Dante Gabriel Rossetti was one of the founder members of the Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood, as they called themselves. That was later abbreviated to the PRB, which makes them sound misleadingly institutional, like a bank or a building society. They weren't like that at all.
The truth is that although they used religious imagery, the PRB weren't so much a spiritual brotherhood as a temporary gang of young men. We thought at least as much about sex as they did about religion. Lorenzo and Isabella by Millais is another early PRB production. It's based on a poem by Keats. The story is complicated, but all you really need to know is that the men on the left-hand side of the table are planning to decapitate the man opposite for having fallen in love with their sister. It's a picture full of simmering violence and sexual threat, and what a grubby, misogynistic imagination it betrays. I find the figure in the foreground particularly unpleasant. Coiled with rage, he points his leg, which has been painted to look as sharp as a switchblade, straight at his sister's groin. Given the unpleasantness of so much of their work, it's always struck me as rather odd that the Pre-Raphaelites should have been criticised, not for the sex and violence, but for their apparent Roman Catholicism. Convent Thoughts by Charles Alston Collins, a Pre-Raphaelite disciple, was inspected by John Ruskin, then the most influential art critic in Victorian Britain. Ruskin hated the fancy dress piety of the subject, but he admired its botanical precision.
Ruskin didn't think British artists should be trying to revive the old Catholic art of signs and symbols. Instead, he thought they should be attempting to find God in his greatest creation, the natural world.
His advice was, don't paint nuns. Paint plants. Paint nature. The project of painting nature was doubly urgent for Ruskin because of his terrible fear that the natural world was being obliterated forever by the arrival of the new towns and industries. Only in images of trees and plants and rocks would we be able to enjoy nature in all her original splendour of detail and magnificence of colour. Only in pictures would we be able to see the world as God had made and signed it. This mixture of environmental concern and religious quest is what lends so much Pre-Raphaelite painting of nature its observational intensity and emphatic brightness of colour. Every detail had to be captured with as much fidelity as possible.
There's something terribly overworked about a lot of this art, but you have to admire the sincerity and the energy that went into it. The Victorians painted the natural world as if frightened that it might darken and disappear before their very eyes. Even the misogynistic Millet took time off from his morbid relish in the death and disappointment of women to depict flowers and foliage, which are here given just as much attention as the pallid corpse of Ophelia. Artists spent months on end scrutinising nature in the hope that it might reveal the signature of God. It must have taken John Brett a very long time to paint this tremendously immediate picture of a stonebreaker in the Surrey landscape. I suspect Brett wasn't so much protesting against the lot of the poor as finding a metaphor for the hopeless labour of painting Pre-Raphaelite art. It's a very pessimistic picture, despite the sunshine. The Pre-Raphaelite painter, just like this sad, red-faced boy, knows in his heart that he never will find God in the natural world. The places where land meets sea have always engaged the British mind. The tide line draws the map of this island. The beach was a subject which had exerted a special pull over artists in Britain in the early years of the 19th century, partly perhaps because the Napoleonic Wars had sharpened British awareness of the importance of this natural frontier, but also for more purely painterly reasons. Constable painted many pictures of Brighton Beach in the 1820s, including some of his most informal studies of water and weather. Turner had constantly painted by the sea, fascinated by marine light effects. Richard Parkes Bonington had continued this tradition in his beautiful coastal studies of the late 1820s. This picture of Rhyl Sands in North Wales was painted towards the end of his life by David Cox, who was a contemporary of Turner's, and it proves that this tradition of open-air painting was still very much alive and well in Britain, even as late as the 1850s. As far as I'm concerned, Cox's beach paintings amount to one of the real unsung achievements of 19th century British painting. Cox painted the beach as a place of leisure and contemplation. He saw that it is a natural subject, because it is itself a kind of painting made by nature, the stretch of sand a bare canvas touched into life by fleeting lights and shades. In Cox's several versions of this beach scene in Wales, we can see Victorian art relaxing out of its anxious, moralising habits. This is painting with its holiday clothes on. But it was a fleeting moment. Cox painted with such freedom on Rhyl Sands only late in what had been an otherwise rather conventional career. By the time of his death in 1859, this tradition had packed its bags and left for France. The true inheritors wouldn't be British painters, but the French Impressionists. To many Victorians, the beach was not a place for gentle contemplation of light and shade. It was the place most explicitly identified with the washing away of all their most treasured values and traditions. A new and frightening awareness of time had opened up before them. Inside rocks, they found tiny pictures, images made by nature. Visible fragments of life from previously undreamed of eons of antiquity confronted the Victorians with hard proof
that the old biblical account of creation was a myth. The origin of life itself was being called into question. Did the roots of man lie in the Garden of Eden, or at the bottom of some primeval sea? The defining painting of this bleak maritime mood is Pegwell Bay by William Dyce. At first glance, Dyce's picture of a family seaside outing, painted in the smooth and palatable style of so much Victorian art, seems entirely untroubled. But there are uneasy details. How bleak the cliffs seem. How large is nature? How small, by contrast, is humanity? Dyce has included Donati's comet flashing through the sky to remind us that the Earth too is just a rock flying through space. Something has gone awry in the tea-time world of Victorian painting. On the beach, Dyce sensed the imminence of an ending. Not the end of the world, but certainly the end of a world view.
There was understandably a desperate quality to much 19th century religious aspiration. Seekers after God had a way of going mad. Pugin went mad. Ruskin went mad. In France at around the same time, the preacher-turned-painter Vincent van Gogh was going mad. But the saddest quest of all for proof of an unprovable God was that pursued by William Holman Hunt.
Hunt had been the most fervent of all the Pre-Raphaelites, and his spiritual search took him further than any of the others. Rather than trying to detect God's handwriting in minute botanical study, Hunt decided to travel to a corner of the real world which God had once literally inhabited, and to look for him there.
In the hope that revelation might ensue, he journeyed to Palestine. He went out in the midday sun. He set up his easel by the shores of the Dead Sea. And then, in one of the most inhospitable corners of the entire globe, he began to paint.
What Hunt encountered was a sulfurous environment of utter bleakness and vivid hostility. He painted it all. Dead mountains, dead salt flats, dead sea. There's mania in these lurid colours. It's a picture suffering from heat stroke. In the middle of his landscape, he tethered this pitiful animal. The scapegoat, he called it, and claimed that it was a great symbol of Christ's sacrifice on behalf of man. This slavering animal was his revelation. But Hunt had not found God. This is the last sad frenzy of Victorian religious art. The portrait of a goat in extremis. The greatest Victorian work of art wasn't painted on canvas, but drawn on the sky in steel. John Fowler and Benjamin Baker's Forth Bridge was completed in 1890. It's ironic that two engineers, men who weren't in any way possessed by a dream of reviving religious art, should have produced the most genuinely awe-inspiring Victorian creation that reaches up to the heavens with huge and absolute confidence. But the bridge had its critics. William Morris called it the supreme specimen of all ugliness. Although what he objected to most about this masterpiece of engineering was the type of repetitive labour required of the workforce who built it. I think it was one of the tragedies of Victorian intellectuals such as Morris that even when they were prepared to look the modern world in the face, they simply couldn't accept its potential for beauty. And frankly, if you can't find beauty in something like this, you might as well give up on modernity altogether. A classic demonstration of this inability to comprehend modern reality is work by Morris's friend Ford Madox Brown. In the 2,600 words he wrote to accompany the painting, which is some kind of record, even in Britain, the land of verbose painters, Brown attempted to underpin work with a secure foundation of meaning. Brown wanted us to see work as a statement about the place of different types of worker in society. But during the 13 years that he toiled over it, between 1852 and 1865, his picture became hopelessly confused. Brown might have set out to preach, but he ended up by gibbering. Work is actually impossible to read as Brown's would-be compendium of society. The painting is betrayed by its own technique, a hallucinatory hyper-realism, which sucks the eye into a frenzy of disconnected detail. A sunburned arm, a gash under a man's eye, a baby with a face like a goblin's, a Shakespearean fool who's gone beyond wisdom into insanity, bearing a basket of flowers off to who knows where. The most terrifying element in the entire picture is the tiny still life in the wheelbarrow, a piece of meaningless rubbish, painted with infinite pains. This isn't a critique of labour at all. It's a demonstration of the mania which envelops the Victorian mind when it tries to whip the anarchy of 19th century existence into shape.
I think that work has a secret twin in the most disturbed fantasy of Richard Dadd, an unfortunate painter who spent most of his life in a lunatic asylum after stabbing his father to death. He called it the fairy fella's masterstroke.
Dad spent 9 years off and on painting it. It's a fairy version of work, the fantasy of a shrunken wonderland, which could perhaps be taking place in the fool's flower basket in Brown's picture. Dad's is another Victorian vision of a fractured world. Like work, it's also one that revolves around a scene of labour, a Tom Thumb-sized woodcutter exerting all his strength to split an acorn. Eventually, I think you can see Victorian artists simply abandoning all attempts to negotiate the sprawling landscape of their times. They'd worried themselves sick over the industrial, political, religious, and scientific revolutions of the 19th century. In the later part of the Victorian age, it's as if they'd all just given up and gone off for a rest cure. A spirit of sleepy decadence entered the culture. The masterpieces of this mood of dozy escapism are the pictures Edward Burne Jones painted in the 1880s, which hang in the saloon of a country house in Oxfordshire. Van Jones called them the Briar Rose paintings, and they derive from the story of Sleeping Beauty. The thick, heavy, overworked surface of Victorian art has here become a kind of drug. Everyone in the paintings is asleep, except Prince Charming. And he is so enmeshed in the brambles and tangles of Burne Jones's post-Pre-Raphaelite fairy wood that he'll evidently never reach anyone to wake them up. Rooms a harem of drowsy escapism. The door has been closed forever on all the anguished soul-searching of the 19th century. It's the masterpiece of late Victorian art, the dream of a dreamless sleep from which no one and nothing can wake you. There were other people in Victorian Britain who had begun to find beauty in the modern world. They didn't express their values by painting pictures or writing criticism, but they had a profound sense of the beautiful nonetheless. And I don't know anywhere better to understand that than here, at Papelwick Pumping Station, built in the 1880s in Nottinghamshire. This is beauty. But it wasn't the kind of beauty intellectuals ever thought of appreciating. A physical beauty of greased moving parts. A beauty that's touched emotions ever since the dawn of mechanisation. Look how the men who worked here hung their spanners on the wall, so carefully arranged in descending order of gauge. This is more than efficiency. The tools of repair and maintenance have been treated as carefully as any artist ever treated his brushes.
There's a powerful tradition in Britain of men, particularly men, finding not just satisfaction, but fulfilment in looking after machines. It's a very particular kind of fulfilment, and anyone who's ever spent the weekend taking a car engine to bits and putting it back together again will have felt it. The pleasure of seeing and understanding a complicated mechanism at work. It's a very visual pleasure.
All the things that Victorian liberal thinkers had spent so much time dreaming about, a shared social purpose, a shared sense of harmony. Papelwick proves that those things didn't need to be nostalgically revived in medieval fancy dress. The people who worked here were prepared to find the best in modern technology and to be moved by its capacity for beauty, as Turner had been all those years ago when he painted Rain, Steam and Speed. But because they were working class, nobody listened to them.
Once you've decided that the modern is ugly, you're halfway to making sure that the modern stays ugly. The Victorian intellectuals' hatred of modernity is largely responsible for the fact that British art, British houses and British lives are still so dominated by nostalgia.
The village of Port Sunlight was named after the bar of soap that made its founder, the First Lord Lever, a wealthy man. It was begun in 1888, and it's an early example of a garden city, built to provide decent housing for workers. In some ways, it's a very progressive place. But there's nothing progressive about the way it looks. There are many different types of house here, but they're all built in styles that draw on the past. The ideals behind model communities such as this one have had a great influence on architecture and planning. A large number of people in Britain today live in houses like these. This is the street where village life meets work life. A high wall screens a row of cottages from the one thing that this picturesque architecture can't face. A modern thing. A factory. This is what all those Victorian dreams of order finally produced. A snooze of the soul given permanent form. A love of renunciation, expressed at the level of bricks and mortar. This kind of building has become the nostalgic emblem of a nostalgic nation. The British entered the 20th century looking backwards.
To learn more about the British art in this series and where to find it, please send a cheque or postal order for £3.50 to British Art, BBC Education, PO Box 7, London W5 2GQ.